All right, first thing I'd like to do is give you an invitation. The Butler Institute of American Art is in Midwest of America, halfway between Chicago and New York City. It's a rather august organization. It's a well-thought-of museum. It has a collection from the colonial days of America up to the very present. They put in a $7 million high-tech wing a few years ago. And since they've opened it, we've had exhibitions from Patrick Boyd, Eduardo Koch, Shuman Lin, Andy Pepper, Ikuo has shown there, Anna Marie Nicholson, Sally Weber is preparing a show there, and George Dines is thinking of having a show there. So you are invited. It's a very nice space. You'll be looking at the space in just a few minutes. My show was put up in 2004. And the impetus for the show was to sort of clear the deck of a lot of holograms that I had sitting around for a number of years, take a look at them, get them out in the air, get them framed and shown, as well as using a lot of the commercial equipment that I knew was not going to be available to me for very long. Chromagem was a company I started in 82. We had a very nice run of doing commercial works for a lot of major companies. And I knew we were going to be folding. And there was just phenomenal capabilities that weren't being used. The show was called Presence, and this was the opening. It was 4x6 foot digital print. And to enter the gallery, which had a light trap, you walked right up to a wall. So you had to get close to this digital print. And I liked this image because it had a presence about it, but it still had a mystery about it. You weren't sure if this was an insect, an animal, a plant, an alien. So it had that mystery, and it also washed you with some very pleasant and uplifting colors. If you turned in one direction, you saw this reading from the Book of Boganon, which goes something like a drunkard sleeping in Central Park, a lion hunter in the jungle dark, et cetera, et cetera, and a British queen was cut off at the top line there, all fit together in the same machine. Nice, nice, very nice, 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 very nice. So many different people in the same device. And that comes from, what's his name? I just forgot his name. Cat's Cradle by Kurt Vonnegut. And within that novel, he's made up a fictitious religion that two guys invent when they get stuck on an island and the people there need a little uplifting, so they invent this religion. And this is one of the sacred texts. So you can imagine it being said in a Caribbean accent. If you go the other direction, you run into another of the sayings of Boganon. Lion got to hunt, bird got to fly, man got to ask himself, why? Lion got to sleep, bird got to land, man got to tell himself, I understand. And I commissioned a local calligrapher to illustrate it for me, my 10-year-old daughter. As you come into the space, this might freeze. This is frozen every time. Well, it's okay. Here's the space at large, a quick profile of the space. No, it's not. At any rate, you see the space behind it. This is the first piece in the show. I don't know why this is, we had it showing full size. All right. This is the first piece that you come to if you come to the right, and it's a Hindu blessing. It's Sarve Sham Svastir Bhavatu, Sarve Sham Mangalam Bhavatu. So it's a blessing to the people who come into the space. May all beings dwell in happiness. May all beings dwell in peace. May all beings attain oneness. May all beings attain auspiciousness. So you notice it's not human-centric, it's being-centric. And this particular hologram is a combination of dot matrix. That's terrible with the framing up there, but it's a combination of dot matrix. The text is in dot matrix, so that's a tool that I won't have readily available to me anymore. And the colors, the sort of aurora borealis colors that appear behind it, are a second-generation hologram of a dot matrix. Usually people don't do that. A dot matrix is a two-dimensional picture, you know, just animated. But when you make it the object of another hologram, you get these washes of colors that go back and forth. So the show had various groupings. When I went through my holographic collection and saw what was there, well, there were a whole bunch of nature studies. So here's four of those nature studies. This one is called Life Sprites, and you're seeing a metal shim curved in the background, and it's a stereogram, and above it is a UV curable ink pool of a dot matrix pattern that I designed. So the two of them are over top of each other. Looks a little bit like that. I think you can see the leaves in the background. The stereogram was a very dense foliage of daylilies in the woods. So the camera was panned right in front of them, and they looked very solid and real. And you felt like you were in the world of the plants and the animals. So it was so close, you couldn't see the top or the end, so it implied a space that went off in both directions. And this is the one. Oops. Well, I'm having a hard time getting this particular video to show, unfortunately. We'll go on to the next one. The video is much better than that. This is one of the other nature studies. It's called Beetle Buddy. I was making a video of a Japanese beetle, which is only a couple centimeters across. And there you can see the animal's arms. And while I looked in the camera, there was this little creature that popped its head up, wiggled a little bit, and then popped its head back down. So there he is. He's got those little cootie antennas that came up. And I showed this large, it was about 2.5 by 4 foot digital print off to the side, so you could see that, as well as the not very good color on that particular stereogram. This is a portrait of a wasp. The color on that came out really well. There was a portrait of a beetle in there. To do it, I taped a macro lens on top of a home video camera, so it had amazingly horrible depth of field, really tiny depth of field, but it gave that lush blurring of colors that was pretty good. This nature study is called Duet, and I was struck by the similarity of these two forms, a dead leaf and a dead fish, and how they look like two dancers leaping up. They're embedded in resin, so you can actually record some of the light rays. When we usually take a hologram of an object on a table, the air is gone. There's no remembrance of the air or the temperature or the little bit of fog in the air. When it was embedded in resin, you can actually, at the top of the piece here, see some of the rays of light. And in some of the other resin-embedded pieces, there are pieces of ball bearings and things embedded in resin, and you can get a whole bunch of play of light traveling and dispersing through the piece. And it looked like that. When it's all done, it's put on a piece of cloth with bronzing powder sprinkled on the cloth. This is a two-color reflection hologram. It was done in about 86 on a wooden table in my basement. I don't recommend it. So it's the triethanolamine technique that we were talking about earlier. Rauschenberg is a famous, now there's a few portraits. Mr. Rauschenberg is a famous American painter, and he was at the Butler Institute of Art. He worked with Merce Cunningham and John Cage in the 50s. One of his first works was this goat, a live goat that was painted and put between a tire and these collaging. So he created quite an uproar when he first started in the art world. And the director of the museum, so you know, we're getting people like Rauschenberg to the museum, so that'll give you an idea of what the museum, the quality of it. When he came to the museum and I was asked to do something for him, but we didn't want to tell him what. So he was signing posters. So I knelt down in front of him and videotaped it. And that wasn't right. You talk about getting the queen to do a right thing. Well, you're making a hologram of somebody who doesn't know you're doing that. But at one particular moment, he did smile and he said, "Oh, you're getting close enough to see all my wrinkles." And that was the 2 or 3 seconds that went into the hologram. Now around him, all this mishmash of stuff that you're seeing are some of the various pieces that he has made. So it becomes kind of like an I Spy book. I'm trying to get the off button for that. Where you can look in and see... So, for instance, right here, you see the goat piece right here. And over here, these during the course of the video, this element rotates, and over here another element rotates. He made large plexiglass circles that were motorized back in the 60s, and he did plexiglass drawings and collages, and one would turn against another. They were about 4 feet in diameter. So here's one of those pieces, and it turns, and there's a little video footage of him in one of the early 1950s performance pieces in which he's holding a woman horizontally while somebody else holds her on the other by her feet, and they're on roller skates with parachutes going around in circles for... So that's what they did on Saturday night in New York City. Paul Jenkins is another famous artist. He's American, but he's been living in France and actually has been acclaimed a French national treasure. He did the very, very large canvases of color washes, just color. They're very beautiful. And he was given a Lifetime Achievement Award, and this was it. He made a collage, a photographic collage, Old Man Thinks of Young Man Thinks of Old Man. And he did the photography for it. It was him, and in the insert right in the forehead was him as a young child, and vice versa. So I simply took those two photographs and collaged them together holographically, one in front of the other. You could just see the young man face here. It doesn't come out too well. And they're separated by about an inch or two. And we gave this to him at a dinner. There's a huge exhibition of his work. The Butler actually has three buildings. The one building is brand new and has a very large sculpture garden. And the whole entire place was filled with Paul Jenkins's work. This is a triptych of my daughter when she was very young. This is, again, UV curables. The last one or two were metal shims. This here is a very young child, an older child. The one in the middle there came from this digital footage. I was capturing the footage, and the camera was going. The heads were getting dirty, and I thought, oh, gosh, I really need this. But then when I looked at the computer, it had so beautifully framed her eyes and mouth, and these little squares appeared and disappeared as you go back and forth. I don't have a really good footage of the hologram itself, but it was such a lovely effect, I kept it. And that's just a couple motions of her as a tiny child with the yellow toys reflecting light, you know, in the bright sunlight, so it's very nice. This is the one that you're seeing here was from three digital photographs that were morphed in between it against a UV pool. This is actually a commercial tool. It's a UV curable ink gang up. That is to say, it was a small dot matrix hologram, and a special, very expensive machine took the 6-inch blocks and repeated them to a 4x4-foot square. This is the pattern that's used on Colgate toothpaste, Escada perfume, Schick shaving cream, as well as some other products. So it's a very long and laborious process that involved everybody at the ChromaGem Labs. And this piece was literally pulled out of the garbage because, speaking of things having to be perfect, if it's on a box of Colgate, if you could see any dot on it, they don't like it. So, you know, most of it's going to be covered by ink, but it had to be perfect, and it was checked by a number of companies. And if anything was wrong with it, it could be $10,000, $20,000, $50,000 worth of reshooting. So before it left our lab, it had to be perfect, and they were being thrown away one after another, and I just couldn't stand it anymore. They were, being rolled in the garbage pan, and the light was hitting it, you know, I'd go, oh, God. And the next day, it would be in the trash. And so I got permission to use some of these in an art show. And that's what it looks like close up. And I call them convolutions. And oops. That any better?
Yeah. There you go.
And it was motorized in a motor that took about a minute and a half to turn around. I later learned that the average time a museum goer looks at a work of art is 30 seconds. So it was much too slow. Nobody knew it was even moving.
3 seconds.
3 seconds. It's gone down, see, the attention thing. But, you know, it's 3 seconds, but every once in a while you get somebody who just stops, and just looks. So that's the moment you're waiting for. Oh, don't do this. There we go. This is called Tabletop Thing. It's another one of the abstract pieces. It's just Mylar from one of the mass-produced things for packaging we had, and I had extras of this. The thing is that there's a glass ball in it. It's set on a nice table with the final version had velvet underneath it, and there's a metal ball on it. So this is a prototype of some pieces where the holograms are embossed foil and they're set low, and then the metal balls are animated with magnets underneath, so they crease in and change what's going on. So some of the magnets are rotating, and there's little planets with one magnet rotating around another magnet, so these ball bearings are pushing into the holographic grating. This piece is in one of the other, is called Life Fountains. It's again, a metal shim, and in front of it is a UV curable pool of the same dot matrix pattern. And that's what you live for, huh? And it goes like this. So when it was right, I also put a mirror underneath it to get as much light going on it as possible. There were two lights on it. The more the merrier with this piece. You got an effect like that. You had a very interesting depth and jewel-like quality. There we go. This is another one of the convolutions. This is the very same pattern as you saw before, but two of them were put together, and then they were twisted and bent. I have a video of that, but we'll skip that. Then we come to the series called Gilding the Lilies, which is a bunch of religious imagery that I revisited holographically. This is the dancing Shiva, Nataraj, which represents both the creation and simultaneous destruction of the universe. I won't go into the symbology. You can read about it. It's a very fearsome image. It's both friendly and fierce. The hand pointing down means do not fear, but at the same time, everything is being destroyed as well as created, because no two things brought together in time and space in the manifest universe will remain together in time and space. It had 18 different slits. It was actually shot quite a while ago. There are 18 different rainbow slits. It's silver halide. This is the museum version as opposed to the kind that was published on Holosphere once upon a time. So you get two complete color palettes. One of the color palettes is very warm and kind of friendly, and one is much more fearsome, reddish, and glowing. There's a far-field diffraction pattern that pops in front of the image. Many of the slits, the rainbow slits, are split in half, so you get one color in one eye and one color in the other eye, so you get retinal rivalry, and you get color mixing in the brain. It's a very dense hologram. This is a passage from the Quran, and it's this lovely calligraphy of that passage. So it's all the calligraphy nests the whole sentence together in like one form. And I should know the name of the person who did the calligraphy. I don't have it with me right now. And the passage means to give without expecting a return. And it was simply set in front of an HOE. And that's the effect you got, similar to what many other artists have done with holographic optical elements, where you get the lovely color combinations going on. The Star of David is also the Star of David and the symbol for the Hindu chakra of the heart. And I didn't know it, but when I showed this to somebody, they said that the intersecting lines make it yet another chakra symbol. This Buddha comes from not too far away from here. It doesn't come from Japan or Korea. It comes from the British Museum, where they allow you to bring cameras in. So there's the hologram. And the statue was generally of a matte finish, but the eyes were polished and shiny, and the curators at the British Museum shone lights from the bottom so that when you see the eyes, these lights walk across, because just that little slit of the three-quarter closed eyes were lit. It was very beautiful. So I did one hologram of the whole statue and another hologram of just the eyes, and that should have been, there's the video. This again is a UV curable, and it's just in this particular case, it's exposed and hung with just monofilaments, so it's not much more than a piece of paper. If you touched it, you would dull it, and the hologram would disappear a little bit because there was no protection. But I made, as a matter of fact, you could see some of that there. Now, you looked through this hologram to see a large photo collage, a large photo mural, which was just on the other side. I'll show that to you in a minute. This gives you an idea of what the other side of the room looked like. So you can see there are standing pieces and hanging pieces and the mobiles. It also gives you an idea of what the Butler space is like. It's perfect for holography. It has no ambient light coming in. It has a light lock as you come in. It has track lighting on three walls. And it has a drop ceiling where you could put diode lasers in at any point. And most of all, it has a staff that's very eager to help you and do whatever you want. I mean, they build walls and all kinds of things. This is the photo mural of the deep space scene from the Hubble telescope, which has captured the first light of the universe, when the universe lit up. The universe did not emit light in the visible spectrum after the Big Bang. It took some time. So these are the first stars that ever lit the universe. These are the proto-galaxies, three-quarters of the lifetime of the universe. And it took the Hubble telescope, I don't know what it was, 300 photographs over the course of months, aimed at the blackest part of space. So they thought where there would be nothing, so they would get the stars the farthest away. And that's what it looked like. That's what the most emptiest part of space looked like. And these are the very first galaxies to light up. So that photo mural was about 5 by 6, and it played a part in three holograms. You looked through the Buddha's eyes to see that mural. You looked through the hand. This is a shadowgram of a hand, again, UV curable ink. So the hand moved a bit. You would just see the fingers crossing over each other. And you would be looking back through to deep space. This piece is in the center of the room. It is a... one more minute? Can't do it. Okay. That's it in white light. It's 24 inches. This is it with laser light. When you walked up to it, the white light's dimmed. You saw... it looked like below sea. The sea was above, and it looked like you were under the sea. This was the version you saw the first, and then you saw the other version later. That's a movie of it we won't look at. What is that? Okay, this is another piece, laser viewable version of it. It's called Star Slush, and we'll skip that. Come on. This is the last one I wanted to show you. This is Krishna on the papal leaf. Here we see the baby Krishna sucking his toe while floating on a leaf in the cosmic sea. In Hindu mythology, the image represents the moment when the universe dissolves back upon itself, the feet representing movement either into manifestation or back from manifestation or back into the unmanifest. It is reminiscent of the Western symbol of the snake eating its tail. In the myth, it is the cosmic night, and when the hologram is properly lit with green YAG laser, the effect is like moonlight upon still water. In one version, the hologram is lit with... a combination of white light and YAG light so that the Krishna itself is white and then the green of it all shows around. Actually, that particular version got wrecked in electroplating, as is wont to happen. This version has the Krishna sticking out about 18 inches, and thank you very much.